to Buick Show. It's the Berle Show. It's the Buick-Berle Show. Presented by your Buick dealer.
How I love to drive my Buick. With my love, anytime I drive. Pretty girl and shiny Buick. There's a fellow with so much pride.
With Milton's guest stars, Jack Webb and Lisa Kirk.
For I know that very soon we'll take a honeymoon, my Buick. My love.
You are about to see is trite and true. Only the jokes have been changed to protect the guilty.
This is the city, Radio City, New York. All the big television shows come from here. This is the nerve center of television. The Milton Berle Show comes from here. He's got a lot of nerve. More about him later. My beat is usually Los Angeles, but I flew into New York on a very important case. My partner, Frank Smith, was going to make the trip with me, but when he got to the airport, he found that he couldn't go. Something was up. His airplane. He missed it. When I got to New York, I went straight to the home of the man who had called me in on a special assignment.
My name's Friday. All right, now, mister, you've brought some pretty serious charges against somebody. As I understand it, you say your jokes are being stolen off your television program. Is that right, Mr. Caeser?
Yeah, that's right. Set up a nice show of shows.
And you say that the man you suspect of stealing the jokes off your program is Milton Berle.
Well, I wouldn't say suspect, you know, Milton Berle. I know it's Milton Berle. And what gets me is that I just can't believe it, you know? I just can't believe that Milton Berle would steal a joke.
Well, Mr. Caeser, if you can't believe it, how can you be sure that it is Berle?
Well, I mean, I'm not saying I'm sure. I'm so sure I'm positive. You see, I mean, I can't believe that it's him, you understand? Because, I mean, he's such a nice guy, such a wonderful fellow that I don't believe that he would rob and steal and tear away material from somebody because he's such a nice fellow. You know what I mean?
Yes, sir, I do. Is he a friend of yours, Mr. Caeser?
That's what hurts. He is. I mean, he comes over the house, you know. After all, we break bread together, you know? And now he's breaking my jokes in on his program, you know? I don't see that. I just can't believe that Milton Berle would steal a joke, you know? And not him. I don't know.
Well, try to take it easy, Mr. Caeser.
It's quite a shock, you know? I understand it, I don't mind him taking a few show jokes, you know, after the show on Saturday. That's fine, you know? But lately he's been taking them before the show on Saturday, you know?
Before they get on your program?
Yes, before they get on the program.
Well, I can't believe it. I simply cannot believe it, Mr. Caeser.
I can't believe it. But I'll prove it to you! Now, look. Here it is. I'm going to write a joke now, you understand?
Mm-hmm.
A joke nobody ever heard of before. This is it,
all right?
Here's the joke. I'm going to write it right down now. Now, nobody ever heard this joke. Now, the joke is this. Uh-huh. Here's the joke. Nobody ever heard it. Marilyn Monroe is in the picture, How to Marry a Millionaire, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I read her book, and in her book, she doesn't say how to marry a millionaire.
Marilyn Monroe wrote a book?
Here's the joke. The Monroe Doctrine. Huh? If he uses that, he's nuts. All right. Right? We got it. I'm gonna take the joke, lock it up in the safe. Okay? Spin the dial. Now, you saw the joke go into the safe, right? Now, I'll bet you any amount of money that he uses that joke on his program tonight.
Yeah, well, I'm soon gonna find out how he does that. I'm going over to the center theater. He's having a rehearsal over there now. I want to talk to him. I'll tell you something, Mr. Caeser. If he uses that joke tonight, he's going to have to use mental telepathy. Now, as I understand it, there's nothing mental about Berle. Well, I'll report back to you, Mr. Caeser.
Right. Thank you, Sarge. Milton Berle's still a joke. Unbelievable. Just unbelievable. Unbelievable. Bites me right here.
Bye-bye, baby. Remember, you're my baby. When they give you the eye,
we will.
You know that I always care, and I'll always be glad. Though I'm on the loose, you can bet I'll be on the square. You may be gloomy,
aww,
but I want you to listen to me. When that rainbow will shine, though I'll be gone for a while, I know that I'll be smiling, but I'll miss your babies by and by.
Aww.
Darling, in my way. From this moment on, you bore me, dear. Only 2:14, dear. From this moment on, from this happy day, no more blue songs, only hoop-de-doo songs. From this moment on, for you've got the love I need so much, got the skin I love to touch, got the arms to hold me tight, got the sweet lips to kiss me goodnight. From this moment on, you and I, babe, will be riding high, babe. Every care is gone from this moment on.
By and by. Ooh.
with my baby. By and by.
I kill that set. Kill. Very good dress rehearsal, girls. Wonderful kids. You all out of breath, huh?
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, you all did very, very well. The number was nice. It wasn't good, and it wasn't bad. It was just in between, good and bad. You know what I mean? I really think... And look, the faces on you got all sad faces. Now, all said, be happy, be gay. This program is not strike it rich, you know. Smile, be happy. After all, girls, I can't marry everybody, you know. That's it. Smile. Be happy. Think, while you're dancing, think of the check you're going to get. Well, think of the check you'd like to get. She's not smiling. She's laughing.
I'm thinking of the check you're going to get.
Yes, it's true. Uncle Milty makes a fat sum, but when Uncle Sammy gets through with it, he trims the fat. That's what he does. Thank you, kids. I'll see you later.
Bye.
Lisa, I want to tell you, you're going to be wonderful, and your voice is wonderful. You've got one of the nicest voices I've ever seen. You have about a size 12 voice. That's a very, very pretty outfit, but I wouldn't wear that costume on the show tonight. I wouldn't wear that tonight.
Well, before you changed your program, you did.
That's true. I was stunning in my Christine Dior's. I was the Marjorie Main of Channel 4. But I want to tell you something. I wouldn't worry, because tonight on the program, you're going to be wonderful. Absolutely wonderful.
Oh, Milton, I'm a little nervous.
What are you nervous about?
I am.
Well, Lisa, I'll be on with your stage every minute.
That's what I'm nervous about.
I understand that you've never really been on a big show before, have you?
Why, Milton, I've been on with Donald O'Connor, Abbott and Costello, Martin and Lewis, and all...
Honey, I'm not talking about panel shows. You see, I mean... Just look, I want to fix up the opening for you, and everything will be... Here's what I want you to do.
What?
I want you to get out of the costume, and the opening, I'm going to get you some beautiful flowers, and you come out with flowers, all right?
Fine.
You go to your dressing room. I'll get the stagehand to get me flowers. Francis! Francis! Francis!
All right, loudmouth, you want to wake up the whole network?
I'm calling you. Why didn't you answer? Did you hear me calling you?
I thought you were calling Chloe.
Chloe? No, I was calling Schmoey.
Chloe was calling Schmoey.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so clever.
Yeah.
So whimsical.
Here it is. Francis the Mule. Come on.
Francis the Talking Mule.
Yeah, that's right.
Another bon mot.
Yeah. Very cool.
Such sophisticated repartee.
Yeah, I have very sophisticated.
You're a regular Wild Oscar.
I was... You mean Oscar Wilde?
Now, I'm talking about Wild Oscar. It's a crazy guy who lives in my neighborhood. They took him away. Get your 20 paws off me. You're dampening the Dacron.
Dampening the Dacron?
Big man. Why NBC keeps you on, I'll never know.
Well, I happen to be very big at NBC. They handle me with kid gloves.
Sure, they wouldn't dare touch you with bare hands.
Now, come on. Francis, why don't you go to work for some other network? I'll give you references. You go to work. You tell them I mention your name. You go to work.
Mention your name?
Yeah, go to work.
Trying to keep me out of work,
I've become very, very big. After all, the name of Milton Berle is magic.
Sure is.
Sure, it's magic.
Oh, magic. I thought you said tragic.
Now, stop. Now, don't be funny. Don't be funny.
Don't be funny, he said.
No.
Just because you gave up, does that mean I should?
Now, stop it. Now, Lisa, I'm very fast. I think very fast. I have a trigger mind.
You got a face like Trigger, too.
I can't take you anymore. I'm getting sick and tired of you picking on me and heckling me. You're making me very, very mad.
Ooh, chip, 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 chip. The team is getting mad. So get mad. Go ahead. Pull out your hand. Gnash your teeth.
Not gnash your teeth. Buick your teeth. Now, look.
Buick your teeth. Another bon mot.
Yeah, that's very funny. Look, I...
Always with the plugs for the sponsor.
Well, I happen to be sponsor conscious.
The question is, how conscious was your sponsor when he signed
you? Francis, for the last time, I'm warning you, I'm going to have you fired off this network, and I'm the guy that can do it.
Oh, please, don't. You're giving me an anxiety neurosis. I may kill myself.
May I watch?
Don't watch. Join me.
Really? That should be done. Somebody ought to put you together. Now, look.
Somebody ought to put you together.
What are you making fun of my jokes
for? Another marvelous joke. Yeah. Oh, what a mind. Yeah. What a mind. Your mind. So fast the way you think. Your mind works like this.
I've had enough. Now go and get some flowers for the set for Miss Kirk.
So what are you hollering?
I'm not hollering.
You don't have to holler on me, you know. You want something, you ask nice.
All right.
You don't holler. Don't start hollering.
Who's hollering?
Don't holler.
All right.
Don't holler on me.
I'm not hollering.
All right. Don't push.
I'm not.
Don't push.
I'm not pushing.
But you're hollering.
All right. Thank you. All right. Get out. Character. Then get the flowers. You understand? Because. Pardon me, you're looking for somebody?
My name's Friday, police department. You Milton Berle?
Are you? Yeah, I'm Milton Berle, but this is silly. You didn't have to come here in person to just see Milton Berle. You could have done what they all do, just put the ticket on the windshield.
You don't understand. I'm from Los Angeles.
Oh, you don't understand. I know you're from Los Angeles. That's the nearest place I could park to the studio. I couldn't... You don't know how many times I drove around the country trying to find a place to park. Did you realize
Now, look, Mr. Berle, this is serious. I'm a detective on a very important case.
You're a detective, sir. You're a detective. So what? So what? You're a detective.
I'd like to ask you a few questions.
You would?
Yes. Do you ever watch Sid Caeser on television?
I was Sid Caeser.
That's right.
It's funny. It's like asking you, do you ever watch Martin Caine? I'm like asking you, do you ever watch Martin Caine?
Who's she?
I was... Come here, Detective. Can we settle this thing out of court?
Settle what out of court?
I don't know. Whatever it is, I always like to settle it out of court. I don't know what...
Now, listen.
Yeah.
There have been some jokes stolen off the Sid Caeser show. Now, how about it, mister?
You got nothing on me, copper. I didn't do it. See, my hands are clean. You can't pin this on me. You think I did it? I didn't do it. Why would I do it? I have no reason to do it. And if I did it, what reason would I have to do it if I did it?
Just some routine questions. I want to question you about some routines. Are you sure you've never looked at the Sid Caeser show?
Me? Why, I... You don't think that I... You mean, are you trying to... Why, that's the... Gosh, I...
How to tell you that anything you say can be held against you.
What did I say?
Here's what you said. Why, I... You don't think that I... You mean, are you trying to... Why, that's the... Gosh, I...
It's a lie. It's a lie. I didn't say anything like that. I won't sign it. I won't sign what you want. Just when I need my writers, they're never around.
About your writers, do they write all original jokes?
I don't know about that either, copper. I don't answer any questions. I don't care if they write original jokes. I got a good thing going for me. I don't want to louse it up.
I'd like to talk to your writers. Now, where are they?
They're in their cell. I mean... They're in her office, 10 stories up here. And I can't be busy talking to you. I gotta go. I got a dress rehearsal and everything, and I gotta go into my dressing room and make a lawyer. Make a change. This is a busy day for me. I got my show tonight.
Can I see your script for tonight?
What'd you say?
I want to see your script for tonight.
Well, I'll get my secretary, Max, to give you a script, sure.
That's fine. I'll be back later for it, and I don't leave town.
How can I leave town? I'm gonna do my show tonight.
That's what I mean.
I was... I mean, corny guy, that's what I mean. I've seen that guy someplace. His face is very familiar. I wonder who he is. Some tough guy or something. He's got a net out for me and he's trying to drag me into it. Well, he's not going to drag me into any net. That's where I saw him. Treasury man in action. Me worried. Wants to see the script. What do I care? Get the script. I think Max has got it. Max!
Max!
This is the script for the show? Well, look, I got a man. He wants to see the script. There's a man who wants to see the script right away. I want you to take it to this man Friday.
What time Friday?
I was... No, you don't understand. I said Friday is here.
You mean Tuesday is here?
No. Now, will you listen to me? I want you... You see, have you got the script for today, Tuesday?
Yes.
Well, I want you to take the script from Tuesday to Friday. You understand?
Oh, yes. Now I understand.
finally.
What time Friday?
Come here, Sunday, Monday, and nowhere.
Today is Tuesday, December 1st. Is that right?
December 1st.
Yeah, well, I want you to take this script to Friday on the 1st.
Who's on first?
He's on second. What's on first?
No, stop it!
Fine secretary you are. The first place, I don't ever know why I hired you. You can't copy scripts right. You don't do and handle messages. You can't even type right. Why don't you learn the touch system?
Milton, why don't you learn the touch system?
I don't want to wind up you. I don't want to get touched like you. What did you ever do before you came to work for me?
I worked for the telephone company.
You worked for the telephone company.
Yes, they liked me, too.
They liked you?
I was very popular.
Were you?
Yes, they voted me Miss Information of 1950.
Now, I'll crown you Miss Sugarnut of 1953. Please don't bother me. We've got the show tonight. So worn out. Didn't sleep last night at all. Murder. You know what happened? The television antenna on top of my house, the wire broke. The wire kept tapping against my window all night, and I didn't sleep a wink.
Why didn't you call me, Milton?
Call you? What would you do?
For you, Milton?
Yeah.
I'd cross a burning desert. I'd swim the deepest ocean. I'd climb the highest antenna.
I was... While you're swimming the ocean and while you're climbing the antenna, would you do me a favor? Would you deliver a script to Friday? Would you do that?
What time Friday?
Oh, stop it. Thank you, all gal Sunday. Will you leave me? You go out, take a rest, will you? I gotta take a rest myself. That wire tapping all night, keep me up. I know what I'll do. I'll have Vinton Hayworth rehearse the commercial. Vinton, I'm gonna take a rest here. Will you do me a favor? Will you take the next 2 minutes to rehearse the commercial, will you? And make it brief, but very, very good and clever. Would you do that for me?
Okay, Milton, you lie down and rest for a minute, because that's all the time I'll need to show you folks a car that has the distinction of belonging to the most popular series of an exceedingly popular make of automobile. It's the Buick Special two-door sedan. The fact is, more people are buying Buicks than any other car in America, except for the low-price three. And by the way, don't let that term low-price three confuse you. Today, there are several Buick models that are actually priced below some models of the low-price three. That's one reason Buicks are so popular. But let's take a look at this one. It's a Buick Special, and friends, you're looking at the most beautiful, most comfortable, the highest-powered Special in Buick history. You ought to compare this Buick with other cars selling in its same price range. This is a big car, big in everything but price. The truth is, this Buick Special gives you more room and power for your money than any other car on the market. And that means bargain in any language. But it's also a bargain that gives you more fun and pleasure, more road steadiness and comfort, more satisfaction in the way it handles, more luxury on the inside. I think you ought to prove those things to yourself. So go to your Buick dealer and look over this car. And when you've done that, look into the price. Look right here at the price tag. The local delivered price right in the city tuned in on your TV set. Take a good long look at the price of this car, the Buick Special 6-passenger sedan, model 48D. And then do one more thing. Check into the big trade-in allowance your Buick dealer will make on your car. I'll tell you, the trade-in allowances he's giving these days are hard to beat. Because remember, he's had a wonderful sales year, so right now is a wonderful time to save money by buying a Buick. Take my advice and see your Buick dealer tomorrow. Okay, Milton, you can go on with the rehearsal now.
Can't get over it. How do you like that guy? Guy Friday accusing me of stealing jokes. Never stole a joke in my entire life. Imagine him accusing me of a thing like that.
Just a minute, Berle. Do you want to revise that last statement?
Who said that? Who are you? Who are you?
I'm your conscience.
My conscience? Don't be silly. I had that cut out when I was a kid. What do you want? What do you want?
Opinions expressed by Milton Berle are his own and do not necessarily represent the opinion of his conscience.
Conscience. So tired. I'd rather be unconscious. Gotta get a little sleep. These twosies aren't bad enough. A guy like that corny detective has to come in and tell me I steal jokes. I'll never take any jokes. So what if they did find out if I stole jokes? What? I can prove I'm innocent. If I go to court, I'll prove I'm innocent. I'll go to court. I'll go to court. I'll go to court.
Who took the telephone books off my chair?
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
That's better.
This is very nice, Your Honor.
You like it?
Uh-huh.
Halo glorifies your hair, soaping it up. All right, Clay, what's the first case on the docket?
It's the case of Milton Berle.
Guilty, next case. And who are you?
I'm Milton Berle's attorney. Now, I think he's guilty too, Your Honor, but gee whiz, let's not make a hollow mockery of justice.
Are you impugning the reputation of this court?
What does that mean?
Don't confuse me. I cut law class to come here.
Your Honor, I'd like to call Milton Berle and swear him in.
You like to swear him in? I like to cuss him out. All right, somebody call Milton Berle. Where's Milton Berle?
Do you promise to take this woman to be your lawful wedded wife?
Now, Judge, I want to just...
Your sweaty paws off at a judicial Chippendale.
Judge, didn't I see you judge a dog show at Madison Square Garden?
Didn't I see me? You licked my hand when I gave you a second prize.
Me gave you the second prize. You gave the first prize to a cocker spaniel because you thought it was your sister. Listen,
let's proceed with the case.
Yeah, let's proceed with the case. I was...
You promised to take this woman to be your lawful wedded wife?
I do.
Your Honor, I'd like to ask one question, if I may.
Yeah, how about that?
How about what? I don't know what you're saying.
Answer the man's question.
He didn't say anything.
Troublemaker.
He didn't...
The prosecutor will rephrase the question. And this time, say it stupid so he can understand it.
Mr. Berle.
Yes, sir.
To the best of your knowledge, did you ever willfully, with malice aforethought and with intent to steal, lift any jokes from any comedians?
No, I never did.
You're off to a flying start. You now have 20. How much of the 20 do you want to bet?
All of it. Okay, for 40 years, answer this question.
Wait, what program are we doing?
You bet your life, and that's what you're going to get.
You owe me a little life, too. I want to...
Order!
I'm sorry, this is not my table.
He broke it. Let's proceed with the case.
Yeah, proceed with the case.
Do you promise to take this woman to be your lawful wedded wife?
I do. What is this, a rehearsal for me for next week? What are we doing here? Never heard of such a thing.
Answer the question. Do you steal material from other comedians?
Well, I steal material. It's just a falsehood. It's absurd. It's a lie. It's See, all comedians' minds run in the same channel. And my channels are channel 2, channel 4, channel 5, 7, 9, 11.
Berle, you're guilty.
No, I'm not.
You're guilty.
No, I'm not.
You're guilty.
No, I'm not. And you'll never get me. None of you. You'll never get me.
We'll have to spread a dragnet over the entire city. You take the west side. You take the east side. You go uptown, I'll go downtown. I'll be at Lindy's before you.
Policemen are pouring into the city, searching every corner. No one knows where or in what disguise Berle may be hiding. Perhaps he's in the subway. One never knows who the person next to him might be.
Your program, I get ideas. My sense of humor makes an audience adore me. But how do I know you didn't tell these jokes before me? Thanks to your memory, your jokes will never die. They'll live as long as I, for giving me Chen writers that I didn't have to buy. Bob, thank you so much. Although I spend each Sunday with you, as friend to friend, what they say, Eddie, is not true. So sing again, bring again things for me to do, because I love to spend each Sunday with you. Jack, 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 I'm a kleptomaniac, hack, hack. When you telephone, he crack, crack, crack. I make a lot of jack, jack, jack. How can I steal from you when you're in L.A. and I'm far, far away from you? How do I know what you're doing on rehearsal day? How do I know what you're gonna do? Evidently, you've got great appeal, but from you I wouldn't steal. I wouldn't do anything from your show, even though you're a Dan Dan Danny boy. And I can't get
execution!
innocent, I tell you. I'm innocent. I'm innocent. I'm innocent. I'm innocent. I'm innocent.
Oh, boy. Oh, what a dream. What a dream that was. So real. On a wide screen, too. I know what it is. It's that cop. It's that detective that's been hanging around. He's playing with me like a spider with a fly. But he's not going to get me into his web. Not me, Jack. He's gone over to talk to my writers. I'll let him go over and talk to them. I'm not going to tell them anything about me. Not me. They won't speak. Not just before Christmas. And if they talk, about me and say one word, it'll be the last set of monogram shoelaces I'll ever buy.
4:20. I found the room where the writers for the Berle Show were. Television writers are the unknowns of the industry. They're an anonymous group. Ulcers Anonymous. They work night and day to create belly laughs. It's a grind that a lot of writers can't stomach. I found Milton Berle's writers busy writing the jokes that Berle rehearses all week to ad-lib on the spur of the moment the night of his program. There were four of them, three men and a girl. I questioned them about the jokes that were going to be used on the show tonight.
My name's Friday, Police Department. Which one of you is Selma Diamond? Well, come on, you might as well tell me. We'll find out anyway. Now, which one of you is Selma Diamond?
I'm Selma Diamond.
Oh. Well, I'd like to ask you a few questions about some jokes that have been stolen.
You think it's me? I didn't do it. You think I have something to do with stealing jokes? Is that what it is? I'd like to know what this is all about. You think it's me?
I think it's I.
Oh, yes, you think it's I? I didn't do it, Sergeant. I don't know what this is all about. I'd appreciate it if you told me what this is all about.
Well, we just want the truth here, ma'am. Would you mind telling me what you do on this program?
I'm a writer. I write jokes. You think it's unusual, a girl writing jokes?
No, ma'am.
Everybody thinks it's unusual, a girl writing jokes. I don't know why. There's a woman in the cabinet. I hold up my end of the job. I write jokes, just like men write them. I don't like men thinking women can't write jokes. That's what I do on this program. I write jokes and make coffee and empty ashtrays.
Yeah, well, Sid Caeser claims his jokes have been showing up on the Berle program. Now, how about it? How about you, mister?
I don't steal jokes. I wasn't raised that way. I'm a family man. I got two kids. I got plans for them. I can't tell you anything about stealing jokes. Even if I did know anything, I can't tell you. It's too near Christmas. News to me. How about you, Jay?
What's the question again?
You know anything about some jokes being stolen off the Sid Caeser program?
Not me. I wouldn't steal any jokes. I'm in enough trouble already. I'm engaged to three girls.
Okay, that leaves you, mister. How about it? You take Sid Caesar's jokes, do you?
What? I don't take jokes. I just take pills. We're busy now, Sergeant. The show goes on the air in a few hours, and this joke has got to get into the script somewhere.
What joke is that?
It's a joke about Marilyn Monroe. Lisa Kirk says to Berle, I read Marilyn's book, The Monroe Doctrine.
It was the joke that Sid Caeser had locked in the safe just a few hours ago. And here it was written on a piece of paper. I asked him where they got the joke. They said they didn't know where it came from. It had been delivered by special messenger. I asked them if they recognized the handwriting. They said no. They said every week some jokes came in at the last minute. They just took it for granted Berle had made them up. I took the paper and went back to the theater to question the other members of Berle's company. Back at the theater. I found one of the stagehands that worked there. I showed him the slip of paper. I asked him if it was Milton Berle's handwriting. At first, he said he didn't know Berle could write. He wanted to know what it was all about.
All about?
Sid Caesar's accused Milton Berle of stealing jokes off of his program. Now, this is one of the jokes that was sent over to the writers this afternoon. Do you recognize this writing as Berle's?
I don't know, mister. Look, I don't want to get mixed up in anything, you know what I mean? I mean, I wouldn't know if this was Berle's handwriting or if
it was... I'm going to fire you if it's the last thing I do.
I'm positive that's Berle's handwriting. Now, who'll have to see to get a seat at the execution? Huh? Tell me.
I'll talk to you later.
Listen, I'd like a seat down front, you know what I mean? We'll make it two seats in case I have a date that night.
Francis, Milton wants to see you.
You like executions? I got a couple of seats.
I'm sorry, Francis, but if I go anyplace, I'd rather go with Milton.
Yeah, well, he'll only have one seat.
I'll sit on his lap.
Who are you, ma'am?
I'm Milton Berle's secretary.
Is that right? Well, my name's Friday.
Oh, so you're Friday. When Milton told me Friday was here, I kept telling him Tuesday was here. And then he said, give Friday the script Tuesday. Now I know what he meant.
Yes, ma'am. He meant Friday.
All right. What time Friday?
Where is Mr. Berle? I'd like to ask him a few questions.
Well, you can't talk to him now. He's resting. He's tired out from last night. He was up all night.
What happened last night?
Wiretapping.
Everything was beginning to fall into place. Berle was tapping Sid Caesar's wire. When he got the joke he wanted to use, he wrote it out on a piece of paper and sent it to his writers. They put it into the script. But how could he get the joke that Caesar had made up that morning? It was still locked in a safe. That's what I had to find out. Berle came on stage to rehearse with Lisa Kirk.
Lisa, dear.
Yeah?
We're going to ready for the number.
Just a minute, Berle. I'd like to ask you a few questions.
Are you here again? What is it you want? What do you want? What do you want, buddy? What do you want? I don't know anything about stealing jokes or anything. I've got writers for that, you understand? And I told you once and for all, I got writers.
Yeah. Do you know anything about wiretapping last night?
Do I? Are you kidding? I was up all night with that wiretapping.
Listen, make it four seats, will you?
What is this? What are you butting in here? I want to tell you something. I told you this before, and I'll repeat what I said again. You're going to get fired. When I come back, I'm going to get you fired.
You're going to come back?
Yeah.
Look who's talking about coming back. Houdini couldn't come back. He was going to come back. He left. He's going to come back.
Listen, I'm sorry, bud. I got a rehearsal to do. Would you pardon me?
Well, now, just a minute, Berle.
Now, please, will you? Look, bud, leave me alone. Now, if you want an autograph, I'd be very glad to give you. But don't bother me, will you? I got to do this rehearsal. I'll see you a little later. Alan Roth, will you play Miss Kirk and I? When lovers stroll along the street, to stroll along with their one and sweet. When this familiar world is through, will you still be mine?
When cabs don't drive around the park, no windows light the summer dark. When love has lost its secret spark, will you still be mine?
When moonlight on the Hudson's not so fancy, and spring is no longer turns a young man's fancy.
When glamour girls have lost their charm.
And what?
And sirens just mean false alarms. When lovers heed no call to arms.
Will you still be mine? When Frank Sinatra weighs a ton.
When Eddie Cantor has a son.
When paying income tax is fun, will you still be mine? When Georgie Gentle sings on key.
When television has 3D.
When Eddie Fisher's 93.
Will you still be mine?
When Guapi Graziano takes up knitting.
And when Tallulah starts in babysitting.
When Captain Video, the ace,
no longer flies around in space.
Because he found a parking place.
Will you still be
I think the number will be very swell tonight. Lisa, we'll do this number. Now, after we get through doing this number, I've got a great idea. You and I are going to tell a joke. We'll do a joke both together.
Oh, you mean I'm going to have something to say on the show?
Oh, sure. This is a joke I got especially for you. You see, you say to me, I just saw Marilyn Monroe in the picture, How to Marry a Millionaire. And it's nothing like the book, And then you say, it's nothing like the book. And I say, yeah, what do you mean it's nothing like the book? And then I show you the book. I said, are you kidding? Why is this? And I hold up this book, and this is one of the very,
that's
very...
That's a joke?
I was... Sure, that's a joke. Don't you get it? You know what the Monroe Doctrine is, don't you?
I don't get the joke.
Well, everybody thinks Marilyn Monroe wrote the Monroe Doctrine, but she didn't write it.
Well, who wrote it?
Did you ever go to school? Vaughn Monroe.
Seems to me the joke needs a little doctrine.
Yeah, well, look, when I tell this joke, it's going to be one of the biggest...
Just one minute. I'd like to ask you a few questions about
that
joke.
Here he is again. Now, what do you want? Will you please... What do you want?
Miss Kirk, You recognize that joke?
No, and I still don't recognize it.
How about it, Berle? You recognize his handwriting?
Sure, Eric. Oh, so that's what you're doing here. That's what you're doing here. You come here, write down my jokes and steal them, and you're going to use them on a program or something? What are you, a joke thief or something? Is that the whole thing? Is that it?
I didn't write it down. I don't steal jokes.
Then why'd you write it down?
I don't know what you're driving at. You think I stole this joke? Is that what it is? Is that it?
Suppose you tell me.
I don't know anything about jokes, and I'd appreciate it if you told me what this is all about.
You know what it's all about.
You think I did it. Is that it? You think it's me?
You think it's I?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You think it's I, is that it?
Just give me the facts, mister.
I'm as innocent as the day I was born.
I want the facts. I want the facts, not the bare facts. Who are you anyway? What's your real name? What's your real name?
My name's Charlie Applewhite. I'm a singer.
What is it? Where did he come from? My name is...
Charles.
Oh, pardon me, just a minute. This is Charlie Applewhite. You're the young boy from Texas that come up and gave me the audition. My name is Milton Berle. I want you to meet Sergeant Friday.
How do you do, sir?
How are you?
You from Texas?
No, I'm from Los Angeles.
Los Angeles. That's West Texas.
Where'd you get that joke?
I didn't steal that joke. Is that what you're trying to say? You trying to say I stole that joke, Mr. Berle? I didn't steal that joke.
All right, cut it out. This is a rehearsal. Now, look, Sergeant, I'll talk to you later. I got to go to dinner at my mother's house at 6:30.
Where is your mother's house?
She at the Essex house.
The Essex house?
Yeah.
That's fair enough. I'll meet you there.
I meant you there. Listen, this song that you're going to sing, the song that you're going to sing on the show tonight, you're going to do a little rehearsing. What's the name of the song you're going to sing?
I Love Paris.
I Love Paris. You're going to sing. Now, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you a very big, big introduction on the show because you're a nice kid. You know, I'll give you a big build-up, and then you come out, and you'll be a terrific hit. I must be sick. This detective's getting me all mixed up. I want you to be a big hit. I never heard of such a thing. Same.
In the springtime, I love Paris in the fall. I love Paris in the winter when it drizzles. I love Paris in the summer when it sizzles. I love Paris every moment. Springtime. I love Paris in the fall. I love Paris in the winter when it drizzles. I love Paris in the summer when it sizzles. I love Paris every moment.
really very good. I want to tell you something, son. Boy,
we always have people sit in on a dress rehearsal. Charlie. They don't applaud this good. Charlie, you've got a great voice. I really mean that.
Well, thank you, Mr. Berle. You're very kind.
You didn't see that detective around here, did you?
No, sir.
It's good you didn't see the detective. Listen, what was your name again, was it?
It's Charlie Applewhite.
That's a name? rather than be on my show, I think with that name you have a problem. I think you should go on This Is Show Business with that problem.
Well, thank you, Mr. Berle, but I thought before I could get on an important show like that, I should get some experience singing here on your show.
See you around sometime, Mr. Applesauce. Mr. Apple. I got to go over to my mother's house for dinner at 6:30, and I'm going to drive over in my car. Oh, sorry, I'm going to drive over in my Buick. Forgive me.
All right, Milton, you're forgiven. This time. I'd like to take just a little time to report on two important facts. The first comes from a recent automobile survey of owner loyalty, and the loyalty of Buick owners is at an all-time high. That's proved by the large number of Buick owners who said they plan to buy Buicks again. And here's another very interesting piece of news. It's about people who have been driving other makes of cars. The percentage of Buicks sold to people who turn in some other make of car has been climbing steadily every month this year. Now, it seems that when people try out a Buick, their old cars never seem the same again. All of which means that Buick is having one of the biggest years in its history. I could tell you a lot of reasons, such as high compression V8s in the Buick Super and Roadmaster, the unmatched combination of smoothness and fast getaway and Dynaflow drive, and Buick's million-dollar ride. You certainly should try them. But the big point I want to make just now is this. Buick dealers are getting a variety of wonderful trade-ins. So remember, your Buick dealer is the man to see for real used car bargains, too. He wants to make sure of your satisfaction when you buy a used car from him, so here's his program. 1. Every car is thoroughly inspected from bumper to bumper by trained mechanics. 2. It is completely reconditioned for appearance, performance, and safety. 3. You get a Buick dealer guarantee in writing. 4. Customer satisfaction is assured just as if you're buying a new Buick. And you'll find they're all top bargains, too. So see your Buick dealer's great selection of used cars now. Remember, you get a better used car from a Buick dealer.
I arrived at the apartment of Milton Berle's mother. She's only living here temporarily until after the marriage. Then she's going to move in with them. I had to wait quite a while when I got there. 6:45. Not a sign of Berle. His mother was sitting in front of her television set when I got there. When I came in, she turned off the set. She started to knit. I tried to ask her some questions, but she had only one answer for everything.
Well, how about it, Mrs. Berle?
Milton's a good boy.
Yes, ma'am, I know he is, but I just want to ask you a few questions about some jokes. Do you know where he gets them?
Milton's a good boy.
Well, sorry I'm late, Mutt. What are you doing here?
All right, Berle, you ready to talk now?
Ready to talk? I have nothing to say. I told you everything I know. This is my mother. You haven't said anything to my mother, have you? Have you said anything to my mother? Has he said anything to you, Mama?
Milton's a good boy.
That's me, honey. I know. That's me. I know him.
Yes, I know Milton's a good boy, ma'am.
She doesn't know anything. My mother doesn't know anything, and I wish you wouldn't ask her anything. I know what you're thinking of. This television set. This is a television set that NBC. NBC gave my mother this television set.
Is that right?
They put it in here. This set goes directly to my rehearsal at the Center Theater. It's a special set.
Is that so?
Yeah.
Special set, huh?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to see how that works. Now, let's see. This is the channel it was tuned in when I got here.
No, please,
I'd like to see how that works.
No, don't touch that.
Berle, I want to watch this.
Okay, Mr. Caesar, the rehearsal is almost over. Now look, I just want to come in here for a nice close-up of you and Imogene Coker when she says Marilyn Monroe wrote the Monroe Doctrine.
I get it now. Mrs. Berle, you watch the show of shows rehearsal, is that right? And then you write down some jokes, and then you send them over to your son here. Is that right?
Milton's a good boy.
Well, I guess that wraps this case up all right. You got your mother here writing down the jokes that she hears on the show of shows rehearsal. Is that right? What do you got to say?
Milton's a good boy.
Well, how about it, Mrs. Berle? You get the jokes off Sid Caesar's program. Is that it?
Sid is a good boy.
Well, you'll have to come downtown with me, Milton. Your mother, too.
Oh, no. No, no, you can't do this. You can't take my mother. You can't take my mother because she's got to sit here at the television set and take out the jokes from Bob Hope's program. From Bob Hope.
Bob's a good boy.
Yeah. Guess I must have been crazy doing what I did. Should have never done it. I've been taking things that I shouldn't have taken. Knew I was taking other people's jokes and taking other people's songs, and I knew everything was wrong. Everything I've done is wrong, and that's the way I've climbed the ladder of success. Wrong by wrong.
Yes, now you know. Money can't buy everything, can it? Money can't buy respect. Money can't buy dignity. Money can't buy integrity.
When you got money, who needs those things?
I don't want to go. No, please. I don't want to. Please, I don't want to.
And now for the final disposition of the Milton Berle case. Milton Berle was tried and found guilty of stealing jokes from other comedians. The suspect confessed to his crime and threw himself on the mercy of the court. Milton Berle, the suspect, is now serving 30 years in NBC. Crime pays.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Before I say so long for a while, I just want to remind you that there is no better buy in automobiles than a Buick. You know, ringing down the curtain on a very successful year, your Buick dealer can afford to give you a terrific trade-in allowance on your present car and a wonderful deal on a new Buick. So now's the time. Please see him tomorrow. He's very friendly, and just tell him Uncle Milty sent you. And now I'd like to bring out my guest star tonight. Say hello. Jack Webb. Come on, Jack. Jack, I want to thank you. I want to thank you on behalf of the Chesterfield Company, Liggett Myers, for having you appear on the program. We wish you so much luck. I know that you're going to win the Look Award for being the best director, Look Magazine, and the Sylvania Award, and you've got to get over to the dinner. Thank you, and God bless you
all. Thank you, Milton.
Thank you very much.
Good night.
Ladies and gentlemen, see you next week, same time, same channel, same station. Until then, may I just say good night, and God bless you all.